We begin 40 days of Lent on this Ash Wednesday of 2021. Always the time of Lent and a reminder of the ashes, to dust you are and to dust you shall return, is a call to repentance. Well, this year we will focus on a little known prophet in terms of familiarity, Zechariah, very near the end of the Old Testament, very near the end of that part of the history of Israel. But Zechariah will announce, "Your kingdom comes." That's our overarching theme for the six Wednesday Lent services that begin today. An opportunity to come humbly before God and to really focus on that Passion Week. In fact, Zechariah is known as the Holy Week prophet. It's fascinating to see how much prophecy there is of Jesus, the Messiah, beginning with Palm Sunday. We now begin with our opening hymn, "Come to Calvary's Holy Mountain." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Behold, your King comes to you, righteous and having salvation, speaking peace to the nations, and ruling from sea to sea, to the ends of the earth. God's kingdom comes to us through Jesus Christ our Lord. We have a time of confession in this Lenten season. Come to Calvary's holy mountain, sinners ruined by the fall. Here a pure and healing fountain flows for you, for me, for all. In a full perpetual tide, open when our Savior died. Coming to Calvary's holy mountain, we confess our sins first, with silence for reflection. Merciful Father, I am wrapped up in myself. I cling to comfort and choose the easy way. I want tweaking, not transformation. Greed, envy, intolerance, and jealousy mark my life. I fail to learn, and what I have learned, I fail to practice. I judge others with a standard I never use for myself. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Zechariah chapter 13:1 states, on that day there will be a fountain open to cleanse from sin and uncleanness. Because of Christ's cross and crucifixion, Zechariah's day is today. Here a pure and healing fountain flows for you, for me, for all, in a full perpetual tide opened when our Savior died. In Jesus' name, you are absolved, forgiven, and loved. God's kingdom comes to us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing you have made, and forgive the sins of all who repent. Create in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may attain from you, the God of all mercy, perfect forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We continue with our Ash Wednesday readings.
Our Old Testament reading is from Zechariah chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. In the eighth month of the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Zechariah, son of Berechiah, the son of Iddo. The Lord was very angry with your ancestors. Therefore, tell the people, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Return to me, declares the Lord Almighty, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. Do not be like your ancestors, to whom the earlier prophets proclaimed, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Turn from your evil ways and your evil practices. But they would not listen or pay attention to me, declares the Lord. Where are your ancestors now? And the prophets, do they live forever? But did not my words and my decrees, which I commanded my servants, the prophets, overtake your ancestors? Then they repented and said, the Lord Almighty has done to us what our ways and practices deserve, just as he determined to do. Our epistle reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, through chapter 6, verse 10. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As God's co-workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. For he says, in the time of my favor I heard you, and in the day of salvation I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. We put no stumbling block in anyone's path, so that our ministry will not be discredited. Rather, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, in great endurance, in troubles, hardships, and distress, in beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit, and in sincere love, in truthful speech, and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left, through glory and dishonor, bad report and good report, genuine yet regarded as impostors, known yet regarded as unknown, dying and yet we live on, beaten and yet not killed, sorrowful yet always rejoicing, poor yet making many rich, having nothing and yet possessing everything. Our gospel lesson is from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 1 through 6, and verses 16 through 21. You are welcome to read along with me. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And now we join together for our hymn, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Dear friends in Christ, such an important day this is on Ash Wednesday to mark the beginning of the 40 days of Lent. We're reminded that in ashes that we are dust, and to dust we shall return. We continue to be under the burden of sin, and we cannot free ourselves from that. Yet, our own sinful nature strives and struggles to be number one and to be on top. And so it's important, especially this time of year, as we're reminded of Jesus' passion, this time of Lent, the purple color, that we indeed are humble and repentant before our God. Take a look at Zechariah the prophet. Zechariah the prophet was someone who lived in 520 BC in Babylon. The temple was still in ruins in Jerusalem. So he was amongst the exiles there that hadn't been destroyed in Jerusalem 587 by Nebuchadnezzar. In Zechariah's day, under the Persians, they were able to go back to rebuild the temple. Well, it was under some challenge and duress, and it wasn't going all that well. But the people were anticipating, because we want to focus on Zechariah, the prophet, the Holy Week prophet, who's going to announce and help usher in Jesus, the Messiah, through those prophecies. The kingdom of God, your kingdom come. Actually, Haggai the prophet, Zechariah's contemporary, said, "Go up to the hills and bring wood and build the house. It's time to build." Well, you can't have a solid building without a solid foundation. And God is calling us to build or rebuild. And maybe this is a good time in the Lent of 2021. As we are still in the pandemic time, but there is hope and opportunities for, maybe in different ways, but for life to begin to be put back together in a healthy and better way. We're all called to build something, raising children who trust Jesus, being an honest, hardworking employee, run a business with biblical integrity, study God's word on a regular basis, remember the Sabbath day. It is time to build. And especially if you're feeling that there's some ruins in your life, often at our own hands, sometimes by the actions of others or a combination of both. In terms of relationship, marriage with children, with parents, something with your health, something about your future or your finances, your emotional well-being. Well, it's time to build. It's time to build, but we have to do first things first. And first things first is where we begin in chapter 1 of Zechariah. Let's take a look at Zechariah chapter 1, verse 2. "The Lord was very angry with your ancestors. Therefore, tell the people, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Return to me, declares the Lord Almighty, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. Do not be like your ancestors to whom the earlier prophets proclaimed. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Turn from your evil ways and your evil practices. But they would not listen or pay attention to me, declares the Lord." Well, that's quite an opening for the prophet Zechariah. And it's a great opening to put first things first in this Ash Wednesday, in this Lenten season of 2021. How significant it is then that God would say he will build us again. He will rebuild us. He will build us up. But it's first things first. Laying a foundation, a solid foundation. And it is done in those words, "A return to me, says the Lord Almighty." First things first. It's not the work of the temple that's so important. That is a sign of their love and devotion to God. It's that the people return to the Lord. And unlike the builders of the Tower of Babel in Genesis, who brag, "We want to make a name for ourselves," we know that God would have us to understand that that pride and pretense will only lead to a crumpled building. It will only be undermined. It will only fall in ruin. That word return to the Lord your God, return could easily be translated repent. And repent's not a suggestion to be nicer or try harder. It is a very serious call that God takes with all utter seriousness. It's a call that would have us take sin also with utter seriousness. And return draws us and invites us as even a command to confess, to come clean, be honest before God. So part of building the right foundation in our lives is that we are sincere and honest and serious before God in all humility. I guess it's easy to kind of ignore the call to repent, to return. I'm not sure we're always praying for it or listening for it or even doing it. But we can't build a life of mercy and faithfulness apart from that call to repent. It comes with especially the Lenten season. If we don't, we end up building similar to the Tower of Babel. We're going to make a name for ourselves on our own pride or pretense or efforts or work rather than the foundation that God is going to lay, even as Zechariah unfolds the prophecies of Jesus the Savior, that he indeed is the cornerstone. He is the foundation. He is the one then that our lives are to be built on. So Zechariah also warns about being like our ancestors, others before us who may or may not have been faithful, or those who were not paying attention to God. See, there was a false sense, especially in the book of Jeremiah, that as long as they had that original temple, Solomon's temple, that God would not follow through on his judgments on them. And he talks about how your lips say what I'm supposed to hear, but your heart is far from me. The temple of the Lord was not their salvation. It was God himself. So the temple, again, needs to be rebuilt in Zechariah's day. This is about 500 years before the birth of Christ. But it is not coming along that well. The people are discouraged. It's been going on for a long time. So then when Zechariah comes in, he then brings a message, a call, an invitation to repent, to return. See, that's always a great way to understand the word repent, is to return. And as we go into the next two verses of Zechariah chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, we see that that's exactly what they do. Where are your ancestors now? And the prophets, do they live forever? But did not heed my words and my decrees, which I commanded my servants, the prophets, overtake your ancestors? Then they repented and said, the Lord Almighty has done to us what our ways and practices deserve, just as he determined to do. So look at that latter part, middle part of verse 6. Then they repented. These are the people of Zechariah's day. They wanted to be distinct and different from those who had relied on a building or had taken their heritage for granted and understood the enormous opportunity and blessing and presence that they had to rebuild their lives. There is a rekindling of the flame of faith. It is a new day. The horizon is before them. And it actually happened because of what they did, first things first, was to confess their sins. We see we deserve this. We went about our own ways. It was our practices to serve ourselves and make a name for ourselves. And it's that pride that is always what undermines or undoes us as we try to live there. Now, in confession, we're not really telling anything God doesn't already know, right? It is, it's not one that's forced. It is not about complaining about how sorry your life may be. Confession isn't blaming others. It's not pointing fingers at others. But this is what confession is. And as we move forward in our Lenten services, when we do hold an evening prayer, we'll be reflecting on Psalm 51, David's great confession. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. What's another prayer of confession? The prodigal son. Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, and am no longer worthy to be called your son. Tax collector in the temple says, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Now, those are heartfelt, sincere confessions. Notice they're short, but they're deep. They capture a lot, and in capturing a lot, we come before God. And to understand how important it is that we confess our sins. So we want to slow down in this Lenten season. Reflect, return, repent. Romans 3:23 kind of captures it when it says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Remember, we're building a building here. We're laying the foundation. First things first is confession, returning, repentance. So Zechariah's foundation has the two parts. Let's go back to the verse in chapter 1, verse 2, where we find that this call to repentance is how Zechariah begins his prophecies, his book. The Lord is very angry with your ancestors. Therefore, tell the people, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Return to me, declares the Lord, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. Well, notice how much Lord Almighty is mentioned three times. A reminder of who God is and who we are and that we're not God. Return to me. In that second part of the foundation after we've had confession is God says, I will return to you. That's the gospel. The gospel is God coming to us. The gospel is coming into our world in Jesus the Savior. God's coming to us. We call it Calvary. And right there on Calvary is the cross. The cross of Christ. And there we do see Jesus. We see what he's done for us, even the empty cross, because of his resurrection. But it's easy to miss Jesus. It's easy for our world and our culture to miss Jesus, and maybe sometimes too in the busyness of our life. That's why we're going to focus on Zechariah in Lent. Zechariah, the Holy Week prophet, Zechariah 9:9, he talks about Palm Sunday. Jesus is our King who comes to us righteous and humble. Zechariah 9:11, the blood of the covenant sets us free. Zechariah 11:8, that the people detest Jesus. Zechariah 11:12, people sell Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Again, this is 500 years before Jesus was born. Zechariah 13:7, strike the sheep so the flock will be scattered. In Zechariah 12:10, they will look upon me whom they have pierced. Wow, what inspiration of the Holy Spirit was brought to Zechariah. Because he is talking about God's kingdom coming, and God's kingdom comes when Jesus comes into the world. But it is fulfilled when Jesus gives his life on the cross, exchanges our life for his, and his life for ours, that we can truly, truly be forgiven. God does return to us with steadfast love, cleansing mercy, full, complete pardon for all our sin. And that's why we can see Jesus. Building is only good as its foundation, but praise be to God that the foundation we have is Jesus himself, the work of Christ, taking our place on the cross, taking on our punishment, and defeating our enemies of sin, death, and Satan, and being victorious. This building, then, that God builds in us really is captured in that hymn, our hymn of the day, from Edward Mote in 1834. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. No merit of my own I claim, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Amen. May the peace of God just pass us all understanding. Keep your hearts and lives in true faith until life everlasting. Amen. We continue our worship as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the prayers. Our King comes to us, righteous and having salvation. May God hear our prayers because of our crucified and risen King, Christ Jesus. We have a moment of brief silence. Heavenly Father, we invite you into our lives. We make ourselves available to your holy will. Help us become living examples of your love in the world. Open our hearts to the areas of our lives that need to change so we carry out the mission of our church, connecting people to Jesus, inspiring us to live the Christian life in ways that are dynamic and engaging. Bring renewal to our church and make us hunger and thirst for more of Jesus. Give us courage when we are afraid, hope when we are discouraged, and clarity in times of decision. They that drink shall live forever. 'Tis a soul-renewing flood. God is faithful. God will never break his covenant of blood. Signed when our Redeemer died, sealed when he was glorified. Amen. We join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Behold, your King comes to you, righteous and having salvation, speaking peace to the nations and ruling from sea to sea, to the ends of the earth. God's kingdom comes to us. By his Spirit, God's kingdom comes through us to the ends of the earth. Amen. We close our Ash Wednesday service with the hymn, Abide With Me.